Hello, everybody, and welcome back to the Hearthstone Championship Tour, America's Winter Preliminary. This is day number 2, and yesterday we saw over 120 players from across the Americas battle it out, but today only 16 remain, and we'll find out who's going to head towards that America's Championship next month. My name is TJ Osmond, QD Sanders, and on the first desk today, I am joined by Alex Raven Bagley and Cora Songbird Giorgio. How are you guys doing today? I mean, Raven, we'll come to you first. This is your first time casting on a big desk in America. How's it been?
It's been really good, yeah. It's just the chance to get in cast on this area is really good. Like, we get to see a lot of players I'm not too used to casting myself, and a good mix of actually the big pro names versus the lesser known players. And, you know, a good mix of them have actually got pretty far that we saw yesterday. So, yeah, really good overall.
And Cora as well, this is your first time on a big desk. Mm-hmm. So have you been enjoying yourself? How have you enjoyed the matches from yesterday?
Oh, I'm having a blast. I mean, this is everything that I wanted to do. And the matches yesterday, I think, really highlighted the strengths of the Hearthstone Championship Tour format. We saw some really amazing lesser-known players battle it out and show that they have the skills to really be here and to make it all the way to the World Championship. And, of course, we had some superstar players. We have Chalky, we have Fibonacci. The really amazing strengths of these players shining through. And I think it's been a great day so far.
Yeah, and it should be a great day moving forward. But let's take a look at the format for the 2016 Hearthstone Championship Tour. Now, there's going to be 3 championships, and players qualify for the preliminaries to these championships by earning points through ladder, tournaments, as well as tavern hero events at local fireside gatherings. Each region's players are entered into a double elimination bracket of about 128 players during those preliminaries. And at the end of it all, the top 8 players from each region advance to the regional championships, each one consisting of a $100,000 prize pool. So the Hearthstone Championship Tour, it's a lot different from the World Championship of 2015. Raven, what do you think of this new format?
Yeah, I think it's great. I think the fact that it's just so open for players to actually qualify for this, really. You know, we saw last year a lot of the just mainly the pro players come onto the scene and do well in that tournament. But this time, you know, it doesn't matter who you are, you can qualify through either ladder, some open tournaments. And it just really blows it wide open to introduce us to a whole new name.
And Cora as well, you're someone who participates in a lot of tournaments, mm-hmm. a lot of open tournaments, and your team as well. Has this been a helpful step towards allowing players that didn't really get a chance to shine last season have more opportunities?
Oh, absolutely. I think with more community cups, with ladder points meaning so much more, and with less overall points this year, lesser-known players that may not have, you know, the notoriety, may not get all the invites, definitely have a chance to prove that they have the Hearthstone skill to play with the superstars who got all the invites in the last couple of years. So I think it brings the community together, and it makes it really, really amazing for these lesser-known players, and it gives them a chance to, you know, show people what they can do.
Yeah. All right. Well, let's take a look at the schedule for, of course, the rest of the weekend and heading towards that America's Championship. This weekend, of course, we've been broadcasting the America's Preliminaries, but the top 8 from this event will move on to the America's Championship March 11th through 13th. And, of course, like I mentioned earlier, those 8 players will be competing for a $100,000 prize pool, and the winner gets a direct seed to the Hearthstone World Championship at the end of the year. But we've done enough with talking about formats. It's almost time to jump into the first match, but we have our very own Frodan standing by, who's going to give you some more information about the day.
Thank you very much, TJ. That's right. We are on day number 2 already for the Winter Prelims for Americas, which means it's come to a close. Today, we'll see 8 players go through to the Winter Championships happening in March 11th to 13th, just a couple weeks away. So who's going to be able to get their part of the $100,000 prize pool, as well as a direct seed invite to BlizzCon later this year? It's going to be really exciting to see who's going to be able to go through. We have 8 players going to be playing in the Conquest Best of 5 format. Each player has to bring 4 decks to the series, banning 1 deck prior to starting. After that, the Conquest format remains largely the same from last year. You just have to win 1 game with each remaining deck, but not 2 Warlock decks. It's a blind pick before each game, so you can just choose whatever you want. And it's going to be continued from that point on. We have 8 players for you today. First, we have Fibonacci versus Alexi High, followed by WTY Bill versus Nostum. Then we also have Chess Dude versus Kit Kat and Talion versus Chalky. We're going to see if any of these guys have what it takes to go forth. Of course, this is just a winner's bracket. Afterwards, we have the loser's bracket. I have another chance to go through. Each match that's on stream today should be decider match, although we'll let you know if that's not the case. In the meantime, we also encourage you guys to show us who you're cheering for. Engage us on social media, hashtag HCT, and let us know at Play Hearthstone on Twitter, as well as Facebook.com/Hearthstone. Also, want to remind you guys that if you want to catch up on Day 1 VODs, you can go to YouTube.com/Hearthstone to catch all of the action, as well as see TJ's brilliant purple shirt from yesterday, although I'd really like the blue one today. In fact, TJ is ready to talk to you about what's going to be happening from this point forward and also talk to you about his blue shirt. Take it away, TJ.
Thank you very much, Dan. Dan's still rocking the sweater from yesterday, though, so you can't give all the credit to me. His fashion sense is always on point. But let's talk a little bit about the first match of the day. It's going to be WTY Bill versus Nossum. But before we do that, let's give a recap of what we saw yesterday. It was an exciting day. Like I said earlier, we started with over 120 players that were competing at those Fireside Gathering locations across the Americas, Canada, U.S., Mexico, South America. Right off the bat, we saw Fibonacci and Chalky as well, two players that did really well yesterday.
Yeah, especially seen from Fibonacci, one of the things that we all kind of thought was super strong on ladder and known for one deck mainly. But he's proved this weekend so far that he can actually continue through a hard tournament format and take it with more decks than just his Warrior.
We had Timotim and Rampage. Timotim, one of the only people to actually bring Rogue, Muzzy versus Kogloren. And Brazil actually had great success yesterday. We see Kogloren and Lucas also as well, who were just showed that they were amazing players, actually.
Yeah, and one of the lower bracket matches for the day is actually Kogloren versus Lucas. So one of those Brazilian players have to play against each other. A little bit unfortunate for all the Brazilian fans out there.
At least one of them will advance, though, right?
At least one of them advance, yeah. That's very true. So they can hold that as one of the positives. And, of course, APX Void fell to Chalky and eventually fell in the lowers bracket and was eliminated at the end of the day. But it was a super exciting day. I know a lot of people were pleased with seeing some of their favorites go through while also seeing some players that aren't as well-known go through. And this next matchup is sort of two more unknown players. It's going to be WTY Bill versus Nostum as our first match of the day. And it is an upper bracket match. So the loser will go down to the lower bracket, but the winner will move on to that America's Championship. So, Raven, I want you to talk to me a little bit about Nossum. We actually saw him play on stream yesterday. What did you think of that?
Yeah, it was really good. And what we saw was something different that we've seen today, where the Hunter's actually been banned out. And we saw his lineup do really well versus Admirable, and he actually reverse killed with just being able to lock out the Secret Paladin deck pretty hard with his lineup. But as you said, we don't see the Hunter in this one with the ban, so it's going to be interesting to see how he plays. But overall, played really well, and there's everything to win here. The winner of this gets a spot, and that's how important it is for these guys. They've done such a long day and so much hard work yesterday, and it's just all down to these matches now.
Yeah, and WTY Bill, the other player in the series, people in the Western scene might not know about him too much, but he's actually a pretty popular streamer on DouYuTV, the Chinese streaming service, so Chinese-American player, and cool to see him, you know, play in the America's Championship instead of opting to go over the Chinese one. But his deck lineup looks to be pretty much just ladder decks. Cora, why do you think he banned out the Hunter instead of something like the Warrior, which we've seen a lot of players go towards?
Yeah, it's a bit curious. I'm sure after yesterday, these guys had a chance to go back, review the VODs, and you know really know what their opponents are playing at this point. And his decks are probably more ladder geared. It's the strong ladder decks, but that doesn't mean that they're bad. It means that they're consistent. It means that they're familiar. But the Hunter, we haven't seen a lot of. You don't see a lot of it on ladder, and you know it's just very possible that WTY Bill just wants to ban it, get it out of the way, doesn't want to have to deal with it.
I never thought I'd hear someone say, I don't know, Hunter's a deck that you just don't really see too much on ladder.
It hurts me every time to hear that.
Having flashbacks.
You're the only one that it hurts, Raven. Sorry to tell you. But we're going to start off with WTY Bill on the Druid, and Nossum thrown out the Zoo Warlock.
Yeah, really interesting opening hand as well, because Nostum's got a really, well, he's got 2 out of 3 reasonable start there. He's got the 1-drop and the 2-drop with the Dark Peddler going into the Siege right now, so pretty good start, and the Zoo list is normally favored versus Druid, but Bill's got, you know, double Wild Growth, which is normally pretty reasonable for a Druid that wants to ramp up into their bigger minions.
picking up that Keeper of the Grove on Bill's side is huge against the Zoo. We do see the Leroy Jenkins and the Sea Giant in Nostum's hand. That's got to make you pretty happy.
Yeah, and this is, of course, we talked about it yesterday, a list that originated from the Chinese player Duke, and a lot of the North American players have tweaked the list a little bit, removing some key cards, but since WTY Bill is so engaged with the Chinese Hearthstone community, he probably knows exactly what this list consists of, especially since Nostum played it on stream yesterday and sort of, you know, gave all of his cards away.
Yeah, I think one of the issues here is the Sea Giant, I won't call it tech, but style, is going to be much less effective versus Druid, because the reason it's so good is in the meta at the moment, there's a lot of decks that want to build the board up. With Secret Paladin, we see a lot more Zoo as well, whereas Druid's much more, you know, I'll just drop a big minion or maybe two. And then Druid also normally runs Big Game Hunter. Mm-hmm. So, you know, there's a chance that you can maybe get the Sea Giant down for, say, like 4 or 5 mana, and then it just gets removed straight away, and the Druid can just continue on that tempo. And even with an early start, being able to just clear off that Flame Imp and then just keep the board quite slow at the moment for Nostum.
Yeah, that's a good point, especially with the more traditional Doomguard Zoo list. The Doomguard 7 health actually is very hard for the Druid to remove. So in this case, Leroy Jenkins, easier to get rid of, and Doomguard, it's a little bit more resilient.
Yeah, exactly. And this is looking pretty okay for Bill. He does he's gone into another Wrath, which is pretty good, and obviously the Keeper of the Grove, really good card versus Zoo. You normally use it to remove a minion, and then the body actually trades quite well. He's on 20 health, and Nostum's actually, you know, with the Lotheb there and the constant threat of the Leroy and Power Overwhelming, we can see he already has in hand. So he does have potential for quite a lot of burst.
That implosion is a great pickup for Nostum.
We'll see what it's going to roll, though. Got a 3, okay.
Not bad.
Yeah, the difference between 2 and 3 here is not that much, just because he'd have to trade in that Abusive Surge anyway. The polarizing 4, though, would have been pretty devastating for Bill, considering he doesn't have a swipe in his hand. And moving it into these turns, it still looks like Bill's going to be in a pretty good situation, just because he's got pretty good plays for the next couple turns.
Yeah, it's going to be an interesting, though, because now he has the choice. Like, he's gone with the Drake, but he could have, say, like, maybe Wrath to draw a card and then Living Roots to put 2 tokens to challenge the other imps. But I think the Drake's good because there's nothing that directly challenges at the moment on board. You cycle, and then you just build towards the removal for the next turn. But Lotheb might actually just lock a bit of that removal out.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, the Lotheb's going to be great against Bill's hand right now. He's got that Ancient of Lore for next turn. The Shredder actually makes this turn a lot easier for him, but if he hadn't picked that up, he would have had a really difficult turn, maybe just a Living Roots and a kill on the Lotheb. It's hard to tell. Nostum coming into the next couple of turns, though. He's got that Sea Giant. We see last turn he could have played Power Overwhelming or could have played Soulfire to clear off that Azure Drake, but the Lotheb played better on curve.
I think the worry now, though, for Bill is that in 2 turns' time, Nostum can do Leroy, Power Overwhelming, and Soulfire for 14 damage. And he's currently only sitting on 17. He's got no taunts in hand, so it's going to be a little bit scary for the next turn or so to see if Nostum can just secure the board and continue to push the damage and just really quickly get Bill in lethal range.
Yeah, he's actually 1 damage off lethal for this turn because he's got 6 damage on board plus 10 in hand. If he had 1 more mana, he would be able to push in for lethal, but he has a Sea Giant play this turn, and he could just push face damage. WTY Bill is 2 mana away from combo, unless he had Innervate. So it's whether or not he feels like it's going to be worth it to take that risk. With a Sea Giant on board, it would be hard for WTY Bill to remove the Sea Giant and taunt up or heal. So
would you take the risk? That's my question.
Face is the place, man.
No, I think I agree. I mean, you want to trade into that Azure Drake with the Lotheb, but that's almost a little bit too safe when you have 14 damage in hand. Yeah, and it looks like he's just going to go ahead and take the risk, and I think it might actually pay off.
Yeah, I like this because it sort of now demands from Bill a Big Game Hunter and then something to be able to do additional damage to the Lotheb, clear off the Imp as well. And then on top of that, he still has lethal next turn if he doesn't drop a taunt. So he has to do so many things that he frankly just doesn't have the mana for now.
Yeah, Bill can play the Druid of the Claw. He can play Wrath, can clear off that Sea Giant, but it's not going to be enough to get rid of the Lotheb.
Yeah, he's going to try and draw. Wow, picks up the Big Game Hunter.
Oh, that's big.
That's going to be able to take out the Sea Giant. But the question is, can he clear off the rest of the board and get out of lethal range? And I think the answer is going to be no, just because Nostrum has so much damage from hand.
Yeah, and this is really nice play from Nostrum, because what he did was he positioned the board in the way that because of the mana that was available to Bill, like, he could not answer everything and play a taunt minion as well. And then because he's just sat on Leeroy, normally not good to have, you know, something like that in the opening hand. He would have much preferred something that curved a little bit better, but Leeroy into Pio, and then we see the power of the Dark Peddler just getting the Soul Fire for that additional burst, which is just unstoppable.
Yeah.
The Big Game Hunter was a great draw, but unfortunately not enough mana to also play the Druid of the Claw and remove the minion. So Nostrum is going to take game one against WTY Bill on the back of that Leeroy power overwhelming Soulfire.
Yeah, and that's a play that's really not possible if you're playing the Doomguard version. The Doomguard gives you more consistency if you're fighting for the board early in the game, but the Leeroy just gives you just that little bit of extra reach when you, because you don't have to worry about discarding the power overwhelming or the Soulfire when you're going for those lethal scenarios. But Nostrum picking up the win, that's pretty good start.
Yeah, this is huge for him. To begin, like, in Conquest, it's very difficult to get, especially in any format, really, like, the first matchup, and he got Zoo versus Druid, so he gets the favored matchup straight away. And then to win it, I mean, this is the biggest game of his life, I imagine. This singular game is huge, so it's everything. To get such a decisive win straight away, his confidence must be so high now.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Nostrum, he's no stranger to tournament play, though. He competes in almost every single Open that I've ever seen, just about. He has qualified for a few LAN tournaments as well through Opens, most notably the One Nation of Gamers Gaikou event that happened at the end of last year. So a lot of people that play in these Opens know him, and he is no stranger to tournaments, but this is still probably nerve-wracking for him.
Oh, yeah, for sure. And it looks like on Nostrum's side, we're going to be seeing the Patron Warrior, WTY Bill. Could be Reno Locke. Do you remember? We didn't actually see one of his games yesterday.
No, this is his first match that will be streamed. So
we will discover the deck together, guys.
Yes, it's going to be fun.
This is a good moment.
All right, well, Nostrum, Patron Warrior, when he played on stream, was the deck that he struggled with the most to find a win. But it seemed like his lineup is meant to target specific decks from his opponent. He 3-0 swept That's Admirable's Secret Paladin yesterday, and I believe WTY Bill did have Paladin in his lineup, so Nostrum has to be feeling confident moving forward.
Yeah, and this, although still could be a Reno Lock, because there is a Demon variant where you play two Void Callers, and that's the only double in the deck, but, you know, I think we saw yesterday where there was someone just playing Demon Handlock.
Fibonacci.
Yeah, exactly.
And he's still in.
Yeah, so it works. And this is the thing where we talk about lineups that are good and lock out certain popular decks like Secret Paladin. But when someone brings a deck like this that just isn't common at all, everyone's expecting Zoo or just sort of a fairly standard Reno burst list. So to play something like this really good and catch people off guard. And that's, you know, Bill's in this game, so he's got this far with it already.
Yeah, and Korra, we go back to the ban strategy from WTY Bill. He banned Hunter. Does that sort of indicate that this might be more likely to be more of a more traditional handlock deck?
I think it definitely does. The Hunter has a lot of reach from hand, and the handlock is very good at building those taunt walls, clearing off minions, and staying safe as far as your opponent not being able to attack your face on the board. But from hand, you know, you've got double kill command, quick shots. The Hunter hero power in itself, it is actually quite good against the traditional handlock variants.
Yeah, Reno Lock tends to be a little bit better against Hunter just because Hunter will get you to 10, run out of cards, and then they'll just shoot back up to 30. Yeah.
And then they concede.
Yeah, exactly. So
but this matchup's looking really weird as well, because Nostrum's actually doing probably the correct thing here and just like really pressuring. He doesn't have a very clean way to clear up this Void Caller and the potential of, you know, Demon coming out afterwards. And he's putting him at a health that isn't great for Molten Giants either. So on turn 5, he can still tap and play Molten, but he's got nothing else he can do. The only benefit here for Bill is that there's Hellfire in hand, which is going to be really good to, or you normally think it's really good to actually clear the board of patrons. But Nostrum's just showing that he doesn't really need that board. He's going to pressure with the Berserker, and he has the Corcoran Elite, something we discussed a little bit yesterday in terms of the card choice in Patron. Corcoran Elite, really good at just pushing that extra little bit of damage you need to finish the game.
Yeah, definitely. And we see in Bill's hand, he's got the Molten Giant. He has the Jiraxxus that could come out if he chooses to Hellfire this turn. The Void Caller will die. But there's a chance that the other one could come out, but he doesn't have any taunt minions. We don't see Defender of Argus. We don't see Sun Fury Protector. No real way to build that taunt wall that the traditional Demon Handlock and Handlocks are famous for.
Yep. This was actually a really clever way to navigate this turn. because Hellfire is his only source of AoE damage in his hand right now. And against Patron, you really need a way to clear the board if your opponent's going to propagate Patrons within the next couple turns. And the way Nossum's playing this game, it's sort of, he's trying to bait out the AoE to make sure that he's going to be able to get good Patron turns. So really great to hold off on the AoE and make sure that he has that for a Patron swing.
Yeah, this is looking like it's going to be a really big swing turn for Bill, though. He still has the Void Caller on board, whereas Nostum chose to just go face instead. And now he can Molten, he can heal bot, and just push himself back up to a much more stable health and put a lot of pressure in return.
Yeah, he could even just choose to go with the Molten, the other Void Caller, or Acidic Swamp Ooze, and then put the Sun Fury Protector on the Molten and another minion.
Yeah, that's also true. The Deathbite is sort of the key to success for Patron Warriors, just because so much of their power stems from that. The Whirlwind effect gives them more cards with Battle Rage, propagates more Patrons, gives them armor from Armorsmith in certain matchups. It's the most important card in this deck, so being able to use that moves on this turn is such a strong play.
Yeah, and what's good about this is setting up the defensive sort of stance on the board for Bill. Like, we're still quite early into the game. Nostum's put a lot of pressure on quickly, but Bill knows there's not going to be any sort of, you know, Grom shenanigans coming out. So if there was like an execute on the giant Whirlwind effect, then Grom to finish the game, he knows that just can't happen. So setting this up and then getting maybe the heal bot off a little bit later and just surviving until he can maybe Jiraxxus is a really strong play. And one of those, maybe not too obvious to newer players, but something that you should really push for. You've got to know what your opponent can do every turn.
Yeah, definitely. We see another Defender of Argus coming into Bill's hand, which was really the only card, again, that he was lacking as a minion to give taunt to his other minions. So now with that antique Healbot, the Defender of Argus, the Lotheb to shut down those really big Patron turns, and the Hellfire to clear off the minions on the board, he has pretty much everything he needs.
Yeah, and there's even the potential of the Void Caller bringing out Jiraxxus onto the board, and then combined with the Defender of Argus, we've just seen one execute go onto the Molten Giant, so that is a very, very big taunt minion that the Warrior is going to really struggle to deal with.
And the Jiraxxus does come onto the field.
I feel like I've entered a time machine.
But I kind of like
it. It's been so long since I've seen, you know, the Demon Handlock or Handlock versus Patron Warrior. And even back then, a lot of times, towards the end of the Patron era, people said that Patron was sometimes favored in this matchup. But without the ability to do ridiculous amounts of damage from hand, this matchup just kind of seems like you're fighting against a huge current here as the Patron Warrior.
Yeah, and even back in the day with that sort of burst from hand, it was still difficult if they would say, like, double Molten Taunt up, because you would still need to execute or, like, push Frothing Berserkers into it to just clear them off and then continue pushing. But this is looking really good, especially because Bill's got a two-mana Big Game Hunter. He can still Lotheb, he can then taunt up the minions, so he has so many options. And this is why a lot of players like a deck like this, because you normally, because of the Warlock's life tap, you have a lot of cards, which then has the knock-on effect of having a lot of options and, you know, make the chance of making very intricate plays.
And you know what, come to think of it, bringing this Demon Handlock seems like a really heads-up move by Bill. It's very strong against Patron Warriors, which you could have looked at Europe last week and assumed that you would see a decent amount of. Also pretty good against Control Warriors. You've got that Lord Jiraxxus. You can build some huge minions. And if they just don't have that early removal, it's very difficult for them to clear the board without, say, a Brawl or those Shield Slams, those Executes. Also, not terrible against aggro decks. If you see Secret Paladin, it's got the double Molten Giant. It's got the Hellfire. We're assuming Shadow Flame, Mortal Coil. It's actually fitting really well into this tournament meta.
Yeah, it brings up the consistency as opposed to Reno, which is also good, but sometimes suffers from not drawing into your key one-ups in the deck, and it opens up space for you to ban Druid consistently. And a player like Nostum, who doesn't have Druid, if I recall correctly, it opens you up to ban just whatever you want, whatever you don't want to play against. So pretty cool idea for WTY Bill and Fibonacci and whoever else decided to bring the Demon Handlock.
Yeah, and we can see that Nostum's really got an uphill climb here. I mean, there's so much power on the board. The Defender
Actually,
of Argus comes
I
down. Is that
think
just,
it's just lethal with the Hellfire
have you
and
done the
Argus.
Counting? This is all on you now,
Corey. It's been a while. Yes, it's lethal.
Okay.
Ha! Got it.
But yes, I'll wait till he gets to 2 health. It's lethal, guys. We got this.
It's been a while since I've taken a math class, but my basic counting skills are pretty intact.
Okay. Oh, he's dead. I think it's lethal.
It looks like he's dead. Okay,
you
I think that was
it.
Lethal.
All right. Well, that's going to be WTY Bill tying up the series 1-1. And now both players have sort of those signature decks for them, at least throughout the tournament has gone so far. We've only seen WTY build once, but I'm going to call the Team Manlock one of his signature decks. Both players taking a win with Warlock.
Yeah, it's pretty crazy, and two very different Warlocks as well. So really good, and I'm always interested to see these players who actually decide to bring a lineup versus what they think the tournament metagame is going to be for that specific event, as opposed to just bringing, I'm just going to bring like the best ladder decks and just hope the general power's enough. Whereas calls like that Demon Handler, we can see there, just perform really well, and actually would have performed well versus most of the lineup, especially with the Hunter ban.
Yeah, like I said before, it just seems like a really heads-up choice by Bill. You can bring the three solid ladder decks. Consistency is, of course, a huge factor in familiarity. But when you really sit down and you plan against what you think you're going to be playing against, it can be huge. You can come out so ahead of your opponents. And that surprise factor is something that you can never really rule out.
Yeah, and now we're sort of down to a best of three. And looking at the deck lineups, it's going to be interesting. We don't know what Paladin WTY Bill is running. It could be. Anything can happen. We've only seen it once, I believe, from Lucas, the Brazilian player.
I will fight with honor.
That doesn't look like it's going to be anything can happen. Probably Secret, but still could be mid-range. It's Egg Paladin!
Yes!
Oh my goodness.
Yes.
So basically, this is the America's scene taking notes from EU. I'm going to decide.
Okay.
And you're just stealing one of our decks.
Which I'm so excited
which is
right now.
I'll have you know.
Rob is going to be so mad he missed this.
WTY Bill has been playing this deck for years.
Oh, okay. You would say that, TJ.
He played it before Yambre made it cool.
Yeah.
He played it before eggs were even made.
Yeah. And, you know, the stakes are really high for this match in particular, for the first couple matches that we're going to broadcast today. This is the upper bracket round of eight, which means the winner of this match moves on to the America's Championship. Not only do they secure themselves a chunk of that $100,000 prize pool, but they also secure themselves lots of points towards the spring season. And if they win the America's Championship, that automatic seed into the World Championship at the end of the year. So this is that first step, getting that win, make it to the America's Championship. So lots on the line for this match.
Yeah, and I love seeing this Paladin for Bill, because this really shows that regardless of everyone or the general people believing that, everyone just plays Secret Paladin, it's always Patron Warrior. This shows that you can actually innovate and play interesting decks. And let's be honest, this is one of the highest level competitions anyone's ever going to enter. You know, it doesn't get much more high stakes than this. And already we've just seen the egg get some work done.
This is overpowered. Look at this.
It's too
overpowered. Calling it now.
Blizzard,
please nerf,
please.
Yeah. So we're probably going to see if this deck becomes popular.
Yeah, this is really good. What happens if the egg gets executed? It just comes back as a 4/4.
Yeah. It's pretty nuts. And, Patron Warrior is one of the decks that can deal with, big flooded boards like this pretty easily, because they can make big flooded boards with a lot less resources than, say, an Egg Paladin can, who have to have those eggs, who have to have those activators. And they do sacrifice some of that, either late game power or early game power, in order to fit in Nerubian eggs or dragon eggs, what have you. So I really want to see the rest of this deck and how it plays out.
Yeah, generally the Patron Warrior has a really good matchup against the Secret Paladins, against the Paladins in general, because the Patrons can just build off of all the lower attack minions. How do you think the eggs change this matchup, Raven? Mm.
Yeah, this is it's a real tough one, because what it means is normally Warrior's really good at using its resources to just remove minions off the board. But with the cards like the eggs, as well as combined with things like maybe, you can see secrets in there sometimes, like Avenge, a lot of Blessing of Kings, things like that. It makes like you remove the minion with something like Execute, but then it's still there and it's still a threat. So I think the Patron Warrior really has to do and stick to the standard game plan of I'm going to put patrons onto the board, and because they trade so well and duplicate, once I've got that board, I'm going to hold on to it and then push the win from there. But it's going to be really difficult, because let's be honest, if you came up against this deck, you generally just don't know. As we're saying, we want to see more of it, because we just don't know what's in there, and it's really difficult to play around cards that could or could not be in the deck.
What's funny is I was actually talking to Nawsome a few days ago, and I was listening to him talk to some of the other players that are playing in the America preliminary, and as they were preparing decks, they were saying, what are we going to take if someone brings Egg Druid or Egg Paladin? And another player said, oh, nobody's going to bring Akon. They're like, okay, okay, next deck. So in their preparation, they gave it a mention, but then they just sort of skipped over it, which is kind of funny because now Nostum is on the verge of qualifying through and has to go up against that Egg Paladin.
Yeah, and this is the really funny thing about Egg Paladin specifically, because of where Paladin is at the moment in terms of the sheer power of Secret Paladin, everyone preps to beat that, right? Mm-hmm. And then, so you're like, okay, and you're not going to ban it if you prep to beat it, but then when it comes out and it's Egg, or like we saw Lucas yesterday play Murloc, then it just changes your strategy completely, and suddenly you just start thinking, oh, this deck's just going to take a game from me, and it, you know, take a very important game as well, as we're sitting at 1-1.
This makes me really curious to see what Bill's third deck is. I believe it's a druid. Oh,
yeah.
Okay.
It's a
druid.
It could be mech druid, beast druid.
Well, Chalky,
egg druid.
Chalky, another player in the upper round of eight, actually has aggro druid in his line. You know, the old school fell reavers. So it really could be anything. And did anybody else? So. I've been glancing up at WTY Bill's face there, and I was like, wow, he's so stoic. He's so calm. Look at him. He's just straight-faced. That's actually a still photo. Nasim's been moving around.
Makes a lot of sense.
Yeah. He just never blinks.
Yeah, never
and
blinks.
And somehow controlling the mouse without moving any part of his body. He's just used his mind.
Like a
statue. This is how good this guy is.
Yeah, that was pretty funny. I just noticed that.
Oh, my gosh.
So this ghoul into the patron is going to be pretty useful. It's going to clear the board. And the benefit is that when the ghoul dies, it's probably going to be on Bill's turn, so the secrets won't proc. And then the board will be clear for him to have to follow up. He does have Mysterious Challenger, though, so there's actually a chance he might play Mysterious Challenger and just not attack mm-hmm. the ghoul. There's no reason to kill it, because Mysterious Challenger becomes much more powerful when there's more minions on the board, because you generally don't want the Avenge to land on the Mysterious Challenger itself, because it means that the power is not spread across the board, and one single removal can deal with it.
Yeah, this isn't the same Egg Paladin that we saw last week, to the extent of, you know, Elven Archer's Dragon Eggs. I think this is more of, I can't remember if it was Silent Storm who made the Nerubian Egg Secret Paladin. It was one of the more prominent players sort of innovated the Secret Paladin by just putting in those Nerubian Eggs, I believe a second Blessing of Kings, and it actually just enhanced the deck. So I think that's what we're seeing right now, instead of Dragon Eggs, Elven Archer, which was really out of left field. But you know what? I think it has that same element of surprise factor and that same effectiveness.
Yeah, and both Silent Storm and WTY Bill are both two players that have a lot of connections with the Chinese Hearthstone scene. Silent Storm, of course, being a part of Team Celestial and knowing a lot of the Celestial guys. So it might be a deck that's making its rounds now into the Americas, which is pretty cool to see because of how creative of a deck it is. But we're seeing Nostum now sort of attempt to mount a comeback. He's going to be able to place Dr. Boom on a board with a couple patrons, and that's about the best situation you can hope for on a post-Mysterious Challenger turn.
Yeah, and especially because the Avenge, it could have hit any of the other targets so easily, but it did hit the Mysterious Challenger, and this is the power of now. He's put multiple threats on the board, and however powerful that singular minion is, because he's not under pressure of like lethal or anything this turn, then like it can only attack one of these minions, right? So there's, you know, the 7-7, but then the patrons are at such a high priority as well. So a bit of a rough turn for Bill, but there's always the turn where you just drop Tyrion as well.
Yeah, Blizzard's never said it, but I'm pretty sure that Avenge is pre-programmed to like 70-80% of the time hit on the Mysterious Challenger, and then you can just Big Game Hunter, or you can clear the rest of the board. Like, it just seems like it happens so frequently. I do like the Consecration in Bill's deck. I think that's really... It's not something we see all the time. It's more of a tech in the Secret Paladin, and especially in a Paladin like this, we see the Ironbeak Owl as well.
Yeah, the Consecrate's really good as well in the mirror, because the second you play against someone who doesn't have the Consecrate and you just wipe the board after muster, say turn three muster, then you Consecrate, you're so far ahead. I really like it. I agree, Carl. I think it's really good.
Well, we had a debate about the Piloted Shredder versus Corkhan Elite yesterday at some points, and this is one of those arguments for it. Being able to use that four damage immediately, as soon as it's played onto the board, is so helpful because it allowed Nostum to preserve his Dr. Boom, which is a lot more power on the board. He could swing face with it instead of having to trade in and risk taking 10 damage to the face because he didn't have a proactive threat.
Yeah, and we do see Bill actually draw into a Dragon Egg, so you know he is you know committing quite heavily to this egg deck. But I like the fact that the Abusive Sergeants are really good as well, because it's not like the Abusives are only good at procking eggs. Like, the Paladin normally plays with a lot of minions on board, and trading up's really huge. The potential there is great for Abusive Sergeants. So Tyrion does fall, and the Ashbringer goes on to Bill, and Nostim sat on two Whirlwinds.
Ooh.
That's it.
it's a little rough for Nostim. Generally, the Whirlwind is really good against the Secret Paladin. You have the Muster for Battles. You have just the Silverhand Recruits that are coming out every turn. Abusive Sergeant is a 2-1. And the first one was okay. But when you slam into that Divine Shield, you don't want to see that second one come up. And I just like to point out, Bill is also running a Divine Favor, along with the Consecration and the Iron Beak Owl attacks in his deck. I actually really like the Divine Favor, especially against, we're seeing a lot of Reno Locks, a lot of Hand Locks, Zulox, the Warriors that all tend to have larger hands. This isn't the case for Nostim because we haven't seen a Battle Rage come out of this Patron Warrior yet, but in theory, the Divine Favor is very strong.
Yeah. And yeah, Divine Favor is sort of feast or famine, though, in a lot of cases. Against control decks, it's fantastic because a lot of times you get, you know, up to 6 or 7 cards from it. But in this matchup, a lot of times Patron Warriors, unless they get big Battle Rages earlier, they tend to run out of resources and run out of gas pretty quickly. So now this Divine Favor, in order to get use out of it, WTY Bill would have to disadvantage himself by throwing out cards in an inefficient way. I guess this isn't that inefficient with the Owl making so he doesn't get that last card with Acolyte of Pain, but it's going to be really tough for him to use that Divine Favor.
Yeah, it's good. It's interesting as well because in this matchup specifically, if you're at the point where you want to Divine Favor to draw, if you're actually already ahead, you might not be ahead on cards, but if you're ahead as the Paladin, the Warriors normally have to use a lot of resources to, you know, like to try and deal with your board. So it's just one of those weird intricacies where, like, well, it's normally good that Divine Favor doesn't work that well for you because you don't want the Patron Warrior to have a lot of cards, but also it's still a card in your hand that's effectively dead at the moment.
Yeah, it's very hit or miss, and especially this late in the game. Nostim, that slam not doing anything. Yeah, it's kind of a dead turn for both guys.
Yeah, it's kind of funny last turn where Bill, although he's got the health advantage, he didn't kill any of the minions on board because he kind of probably hoped Nostim would draw Battle Rage and just be like, yeah, you draw all those cards. I've got Divine Favor here and ready.
And he can get Divine Favor value this turn, but, you know, opts to go with the Dr. Boom instead, which I think is the right choice.
It's normally a pretty good play on an empty board.
I like it. Oh, that execute. Yeah, he already had the one in hand. But the Slam Activator is really nice for Nostim. There's the Battle Rage.
He's getting all of his cards one turn too late. He gets the first execute a turn after he kills the Tyrion. Mm-hmm. He gets his second execute even a turn after he kills the Tyrion. And then he gets the Battle Rage the turn after. He would get 3 cards from it. So a little bit of a rough few turns here for Nostim. But, you know, it's still not over yet because WTY Bill does have that dead card of Divine Favor in his hand, and Nostim is still pretty healthy.
Yeah, I think one of the problems is, though, that because he can just remove the Armorsmith with the weapon, he does have Blessing of Kings, and then even Muster, he can just start to just chip away at the Warrior, because he's seen both Whirlwinds, and he knows the Warrior is effectively top-decking, so what one card is going to, you know, slow him down enough to just, like, you know, chip away and win that match? There's nothing that's going to suddenly burst for 16 out of nowhere. It would require, like, a Despite draw then into Grom or something like that. So I think Bill's feeling pretty good, and that Blessing of Kings doing a lot of work, just putting one heavy minion on the board, and Fiery War Axe definitely isn't going to be good enough, going to be taking, or having the chance to take down a 1-1, but when there's so many more on the board, and, you know, Bill next turn can just, you know, refill with another 1-1, it's definitely looking very, very rough for Nostim.
Yeah, and Bill does not have lethal yet because Nostim can armor up, but most draws, another Blessing of Kings. He can't actually play the Abusive Sergeant because his board is full. All right, Sludge Belter a little bit dead there because he did fill up on the Muster for Battle last turn. But, I mean, Nostim is still, he's so behind at this point.
I don't think there is even any way. It's very unlikely for him to find a way out of this situation. Actually, I don't think there's a single card that would do it. Even if he had the Deathbite last turn and he could hit face. Whoa, WTY Bill.
Huh. Okay.
These guys are actually both at the same tavern location. They're both playing out of Washington, D.C., so.
You don't want to be emote spamming somebody who's right in front of you.
No, you really do. No. You want to sit opposite and then just stare at them as you click that emote and just see the reaction.
Real life emotes.
Yeah,
how about
exactly.
That? Nah, they're probably pretty friendly with each other.
I'm sure.
I'd like to think. But that's WTY Bill taking a 2-1 lead in the series. A little bit of an interesting deck. It was Secret Paladin, but with double Nerubian Egg and just a couple more activators, so extra Blessing of Kings, Abusive Sergeant, so pretty interesting deck.
Yeah, I like it because the additional activators you have to put in the deck don't really diminish, because it's not like it's the only way you proc an egg. You can use it on all your tokens. You can use it on your other minions just to keep buffing them. So it's really nice. It's a good style because it's not going all in on the strategy and just going all the eggs and only things that can buff eggs and that's it. It's taking a core, like, strong deck, putting a different slant on it that might actually just give you the edge in a lot of matchups.
Yeah, absolutely. Not to the extent of Yombre's Egg Paladin from last week, but you see, we saw one Dragon Egg, the Nerubian Eggs, just buffing up that early game even a little bit more than the Secret Paladin already does, but still keeping the same Mysterious Challenger, Secret's Core. I really like it.
Yeah, and WTY build just has Druid remaining. So we'll see if there's a little bit of a twist in this Druid deck for Bill.
It I hope so.
Could be Aggro Druid. Could just be Egg Druid. What's funny
bring
is,
on more eggs.
What's funny is that Nostum, during his Legend Climb this season, I mentioned on the cast yesterday, but he was one of, I believe, the first 20 people to hit Legend in North America using a very aggressive Egg Druid deck. So he's no stranger to it, if that's what it was going to be. But haven't seen any funny things from this mulligan so far from Bill. So we'll definitely have to see. Nostum's putting his faith in the Patron Warrior once again.
Yeah, I think he's just taking the good matchup here. Because his other deck's Freeze Mage, right?
Freeze Mage.
Yeah, so that's going to be normally deemed a bit of a rough one for Freeze Mage against Druid. But he's taking the Patron first. He's got a pretty okay opening hand, but I think all he cares about is just getting this Death Spy at the moment.
Nostum gave a little cheeky smile and a little head shake when he saw the Wild Growth being ripped off the top.
I think we all
on
do that, right? Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Even if it was kept.
Of
it's still
course
Wild
he
Growth
had.
Turn two.
A
obviously.
Cheeky smile in return of a Wild Growth is better than the other reactions he could have had.
Into a Shredder!
Oh,
oh
that's
my goodness, this is brutal.
And now he's just like, did he really just get that?
Yep, so depending on what pops out of the Shredder, this is one of those matches where Druids can just snowball out of control. And no matter how favored like the Warrior can be in terms of getting patrons down, we can see that he doesn't have any patrons, he doesn't have a Death Spy, so it's going to be a little bit rough. He has done a really good job of clearing that up. Only the Mad Scientist coming out, which Druids don't have secrets as far as I'm aware, so it's not going to get that death rattle effect, but still, you know, he's on the back foot, and Bill can just follow up with probably, what do you think, tempo BGH here?
I don't know. You know that this deck runs Dr. Boom, and Druids, they are one of the classes that even without BGH can usually deal with Dr. Boom pretty decently. You can just have a swipe and a wrath, and you can usually clear it off. So the Keeper here makes... Ooh, that's tough.
It's really
yeah,
tough.
It's
really
tough. Turn.
You can't just hero power, right? Or swipe face. Mm-hmm. Like, I don't think that's the right choice, but definitely a rough one. And now we see the power of Corcoran Elite, which is effectively a lot of the time used as like a burn spell. You know, you can just trade it with a minion to kill it straight off because of that powerful four attack. And it's surviving is actually sort of a double-edged sword. It's good for Nostum, so he could potentially push more damage, but gave, you know, Wrath target for one for an additional card draw. And now we do see the tempo BGH.
Tempo BGH, Nostum will be able to clear it off, play a low theft to block spells, and then coin into a Dr. Boom, which he knows will not be able to get Big Game 100, so he's got to be feeling pretty confident.
That's such a hard call for Bill to make. You can see he didn't want to do it the turn before. He went with the Keeper instead, which is rough to even give up that because it can be so valuable against the patrons on the board, and the Druid already struggles with getting rid of those patrons. So having to play the Keeper and then give up the BGH, now seeing this Dr. Boom come down, that was just a really awkward set of turns for Bill.
Yeah, I think what made it easy, though, was the fact that Double Swipe was available, mm-hmm. because you just think, okay, well, if they do play Boom, then at worst, you know, as a last resort, I can hit Double Swipe and just clear it up. Although, you know, it doesn't feel great, there is the option there, whereas just passing that turn would have been horrendous. When you just, like, hero power turn six, and it's like, that's it. That's when you know you're going to be way too far behind.
Yeah, Nostum actually looks really stressed in this situation. And how much damage? 3 damage to the Azure Drake. So, you know, probably could have hoped for a 4, but this allows him to clear it off with an Inner Rage if he so chooses. But one thing to notice, Nostum is actually already at 16 health. So he's already 2 damage away from being in combo range. And WTY Bill is going into turn 9 next turn because of the ramp that he was able to pick up in the early game.
Yeah, I would really like to see the Corcoran Elite and the Berserker with Inner Rage to clear the 4-1, because you're putting 2 minions on board, putting a lot of pressure on that this turn and stacking pressure for next turn, because as you said, Nostum's on 16, Bell's still on 29, and you know, you really need to push damage. Mm-hmm. There's patrons nowhere in sight. They're just hiding somewhere deep in the deck. There's no Grom, there's no weapons at the moment, so he really has to, you know, do something to actually win this game at some point, and can't keep being reactive and defensive, or it'll just never happen, because Druid's gonna just continually put this pressure onto the board and just gonna run out of answers.
And even with that set of awkward turns from Bill, Nostum was able to clear off his board really efficiently, really effectively, but I mean, Druid did some Druid things, and now Nostum's down almost in lethal range if Bill top decks the Savage Roar here.
Yep, so there is no Savage Roar, but this is an interesting play. Nostum's gone there. Instead of putting pressure on the board, he's actually just gone for card draw and tried to draw into these answers he needs, as opposed to trying to work with initially what he has in hand.
Look at that Ancient of Lore off of the Wrath cycle. He's going to be able to play that down, draw two more cards, and get a body on.
If he draws into a Savage Roar, that might actually be the nail in the coffin for Nostum. I don't think, unless he goes for Armorsmith, Grim Patron. No, just even
execute,
if he does that, I don't even know if there's...
He can Whirlwind Execute.
Yeah.
Will he play around the combo, though? I think at this point, you sort of have to.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Patron,
I think Patron, Whirlwind Execute should be okay. Because you've seen a Keep of the Grove as well, so that's like one answer. You've seen, I think, two Wraths now, potentially. So yeah. You know, a lot of the direct, I'm just going to kill off a patron cleanly, you've seen a lot of that. So generating just two patrons seems okay, but also when Bill just goes into Dr. Boom, that's also pretty nice to add an additional layer of pressure.
Dr. Boom can sometimes be a liability, but when...
I think on this much health, You can deal with the chance of the boom bots generating additional patrons. But
picks up the second Keeper of the Grove and is able to clear off both of those patrons so cleanly, putting Nostum at 15 health. And now Nostum, he can actually clear off that Keeper of the Grove the same way he did the first with the Korkron Elite, play out the Armorsmith, and put himself still safe from combo.
Yeah, just when the patrons were feeling safe as well. It just, the second they were like, there cannot be anything left. Yeah. It's like, nope, there's another Keeper.
A lot of players will say that the patron matchup is favored against Druid, but that's if you can get a big patron turn pretty early on in the game. If you play Deathbite into patron in a rage with your Deathbite Whirlwind, a lot of times that can lock out the game just right there. But this game, Nostum, was under a lot of pressure early on in the game, despite WTY Bill missing a couple of crucial turns. He still hit the early ramp. He still was able to get to those turns where he could play big threats on the board proactively. And now...
This is interesting. He's going to use combo to clear the board. And then because he has follow-ups like Dr. Boom, like Ancient of Law, like, you know, the warrior's running out of juice, right? He's had to deal with so many minions on the board and use so much of his own removal. We saw, like, the Whirlwind Execute earlier. So, like, he's just relying now. Like, this is a really clean kill. Still pushes for four. And now the follow-up of Dr. Boom into Ancient of Law. Even Thorison if he really wants to. But that's swiftly becoming just a 5-5 body now.
I really like that play. I don't think that's the obvious play. Most people would think, okay, I need to hold on to the Force Savage because that is the way I'm going to kill the warrior. But in this case, you've got such high-value cards in hand, and Nostum only has two cards. If you clear off the board, he will be unable to get a really good battle rage. Oh my gosh.
Goodness.
Yeah. Nostum must just be feeling like everything is going wrong in this match.
It feels like every
single move he has made, Bill's just like got the answer just every single
and
time.
And he's top-decked most of them. Top deck Wild Growth, top deck Shredder, top deck the Ancient of Lore.
Even just like the turn 10 Wild Growth into the Keeper of the Grove, and it's just like, ugh. Druids. Yeah.
I mean, that's Hearthstone.
Yeah, it's just looking pretty rough, but you know, this is one of the risks that you take bringing a deck like Patron Warrior, because it does have inconsistencies at points, and you can't always expect your opponents to draw poorly. Yeah, he got those cards off the top, but you know, it was likely that they hard mulligan for those cards in the first place. So when you have that many chances to draw a card, of course it's going to be likely that it happens.
Yeah, and also every single turn that goes on, you know, you're getting further into your deck, and you know, you've not drawn them yet, so the chance that you super increases every single time. So it's not like anything too crazy happened. It's just Bill has been able to get the answers to anything Nostum has pushed for.
Yeah.
And especially because this is a winner's bracket match, if Nostum loses this game and drops down to the lower bracket, imagine how that's going to affect his mentality. We can understand that, you know, it was likely that the Druid was going to draw these cards anyway, but from his perspective, he got pretty unlucky in this game.
Yeah. Yeah, he definitely had some moments where he was probably hoping for different cards off the top, but WTY Billenhaus double interfaith in his hand, which is nothing useful with Emperor Thorstein. Does pick up the Savage Roar. And that is going to do it. WTY Bill is the first player to move on to the America's Championship in March.
With Egg Secret Paladin.
Egg Secret Paladin and Demon Handlock.
Yep.
Yeah, and that's just, I really like his deck styles. Demon Handlock is such a bold choice in an environment where there's so many druids. It seemed like he had a game plan. He was going to go into every match automatically banning druid. And if he didn't, then of course he was just going to ban whatever he didn't feel like playing against. And Hunter was his deck of choice. So Nostum, he's still in it. He'll go down to the lower bracket to fight against Snail, which is actually one of the Tavern heroes. So he's made it all the way through here. That's a cool story. Once we get into that matchup later on, we'll talk a little bit more about that. But a really great job by WTY Bill moving on to that America's Championship. Not only does he have a chance to secure his spot for the Hearthstone World Championship at the end of the year, he also, you know, gets to represent himself, get a chunk of that prize money, and get points for spring, too.
Yeah, it's really good. And just, again, I'm just really enjoying the fact that he's just brought a different lineup, not the standard decks we've all expected and a lot of these players have brought, and proven that these slightly different lineups and maybe not too common decks can still do the work if you play them right. So it's really impressive play, and I'm happy when that match got through.
Yeah.
Yeah, not the most well-known player. I think Nostum has a little bit more credibility in the North American scene. But like you said before, Bill, a very popular streamer on Douyu instead of Twitch. So he does have a fan base, and I bet, you know, lots of people are very excited to see him go through, and myself included.
Yeah, for sure. And, you know, there's been a lot of players that have been playing the Zoo Warlock throughout the weekend and throughout the last week, too, when we look at the European preliminary. So it's cool to see someone with some unique decks make it so far. And WTY Bill didn't drop a match. He made it all the way through the upper bracket and qualified directly through. So that's just a really cool thing for him. And we look at Nossum, is that Patron Warrior going to be a liability? We've seen him struggle with it so much throughout the couple matches that we've seen of him.
Yeah, it's been a tough one as well, because although we've seen him have a bit of, you know, struggle with that deck, a lot of it's felt like very like rough luck more than anything. Like never quite getting to his ability to draw into Patron is actually amazing, or ability not to draw into Patron, should I say, is actually impressive. It goes all the way to just like crazy. But I think he'll still be feeling okay. He's in the lower bracket. That matchup was rough, but he's still got everything to play for. He can still get that spot.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Patron Warrior may not be what it used to be with, you know, the nerf to Warsong Commander, but it's still a very consistent deck, and I actually enjoy playing it more now because it feels like, I don't know, not necessarily more skill-based, but maybe a little bit more fair, not quite as good, but still definitely a top-tier deck, especially in tournaments and both on ladder. So I think that Patron, maybe just some unlucky draws on Nostum's side, but he has made it this far, and he still has another chance to keep going. So I think we're just going to say this was a one-time deal, maybe the Patron not performing as best as it can, but I think in his next match, we may see very different results.
All right, well, we have one match in the books, and we've already seen our first player qualify to those American Championships. We are going to move on to the next match of the day, but before we do that, Dan is standing by with some updates from what's happening throughout the rest of the Americas.
That's right, TJ. We have our first person going to the Winter Championships. It is WTY Bill. I think Kimber was telling me it's Witty Bill. He has the experience. Actually, we'll talk to him in just a second about it. But for now, we have a winner's interview with the man who is our first person to qualify for the event. It's happening March 11th to 13th, and he is our first person joining us. Can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you.
That's awesome, man. Congratulations on your win. How does it feel to know that you're going to be the first person going to the America's Championship?
I feel great, but I was feeling so nervous. I was sweating on my hand. Yeah.
Well, even though you felt nervous, it looked like you were pretty solid throughout the entire series. Now, I do hear that you're actually a very popular streamer within the Chinese community, and in fact, that a lot of people were cheering for you. Does that put a lot of encouragement to you, knowing that so many people are cheering for you from China?
Sure. I know they're cheering for me, and I tried my best to play well in this tournament, and I was lucky. You know, I do realize that I have some misplays, but I think I just was so lucky. You know.
Sure, sure. But I mean, I think at the same time, you know, you played excellently as well as showcased, you know, important fortune when you needed it the most. Talk a little bit about your preparation. People don't know too much about you in the West. So can you talk about if you are in a team or if there's any people that helped you practice to get to where you are?
Sure. I don't have any team, but we do have a discussion group on the software called QQ. I don't know whether you know it. And there are people like some Chinese players in it, like Nubility and Alan Dan, Silent Storm. They are all in the discussion group. Yeah, so we help each other a lot.
Yeah, those four players are amazing. All of them got to very far into the qualifiers last year for Americas. No wonder you did so well. With those three guys practicing with you, that must be amazing. I also heard that you recently had a child last fall, so congratulations. I imagine that this win is also big for your family, correct?
Yeah, it is. Thank you. And you know a lot about me, I think.
All right, well, do you have any final words you want to say before we let you go?
Not really. I don't know what to say. I'm too excited right now. Let me see. Can I say some Chinese to my viewers?
Absolutely. I'll try to translate with my broken Chinese, so go ahead.
Okay. 你们看我屌吗? Okay, that's it.
Okay, I was too fast. I didn't understand it, but I'm sure it was very lovely. Congratulations, Woody Bill. We'll see you next month in March for the championship.
Uh-huh. See you.
All right, guys. So congratulations to Woody Bill. He's the first person to go through. And you know what? He showcased a lot of his skill, despite the fact that people are underestimating. But when you have players like Nubility, one of the strongest ladder and arena players in all of Hearthstone, as well as Alan Dang and Silent Storm, two fantastic ladder players who went very far last year, no surprise to his success. So we have our first person to qualify, and we have seven more spots to go through, but only a few players do have that chance remaining. In fact, we also want to update you guys on the lower bracket as well. We got some updates from the off-stream matches. Admirable was able to win 3-1 over the Lucky One, sending the Lucky One home. Admirable will be playing against the loser of the upcoming match, Fibonacci versus Alaski High. We also have a few more happening. Amnesiac was able to take out Tides of Time 3-1, sending home the Cloud9 team. And we have Kloglorin 3-1 over Lucas. So we had a Brazilian match there. Kloglorin able to persevere through. And the last match was Snail versus Samwise. Snail won 3-2, nearly defeating him. And he will await the loser of Nostam versus Widabill. So that is Nostam indeed. So we guys have a lot happening right now with the bracket. You can go ahead and check it out. Type Ask Commission Point Bracket in the chat and follow along with us in the process. In the meantime, stay engaged in the conversation. Hashtag HTT, whether you're cheering for some of your favorites or you're pleasantly surprised by Woody Bill's performance, as well as a few other players, let us know. Again, hashtag HTT on Twitter or on Facebook.com/Hearthstone. I'm Frode, and when we come back, we have yet another match happening here for the Winter Prelims. One more ticket will be given out right after this.